want to welcome you this afternoon and thank you in behalf of the family for being here and supporting this family during a time such as this. We've gathered here today to honor the Lord, but also to remember a precious lady and remember her life. Miss Bobby Jean Dickey was born on February the 8th, 1930, in Durham, Mississippi, to the late John H. and Myrtle D. Rogers Betterton. She departed this earth this past Friday afternoon there at home. She was 90 years old. You that knew her know that as for a trade, she was a beautician. She became a full-time homemaker. She enjoyed watching game shows, spending time with family, working in her vegetable garden. She was a longtime faithful member of First Baptist Church. Our records show that she came into our fellowship there on April the 19th, 1959. I told our church this morning that she had been a member over 61 years at First Baptist Church. And we as friends are certainly going to miss her, but those that are going to miss her the most include two daughters, Martha Sue Dickey Hendricks, husband Tommy of Batesville, and Joyce Dickey Williams of Batesville, and then one son, Danny Dickey, and his wife, Pam, of Batesville. Also, four grandchildren, Cindy and David, and Joey and Jonathan, and two great-grandchildren, Carson and Bryson, along with her. She was preceded in death by her parents, her husband, Bobby Jean was preceded in death by her sister, Frances Livingston, and her second husband, Walter Crafton. The Bible says over in the 23rd Psalm that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What I read to you before I read scripture was what we would call the vital statistics of her life. But her life was much more than what we fit on a card or fit on a piece of paper. And we're going to ask a granddaughter, Cindy, if you'd come and bring a eulogy concerning your grandmother.
So my grandmother grew up in Durham, Mississippi, but she moved to Crowder, and that's where she was raised. And one day she told us that she was the valedictorian of her class. Now, I saw her report card, and it was not all A's at all. But she swore up and down she was the valedictorian and laughed about it because she said that the only class or subject that she was really good at was at recess. So when she was 17, she married Joseph Denzel. This was back in 1947, and the two of them were working at the hosiery mill. And then when the third child, Joyce, came along, she decided to go back to school and major in cosmetology. And so she opened her own beauty shop here in town with a few of her friends. And I've heard some interesting stories about how her kids became the guinea pigs. They got bangs. Some of them got extremely short bangs. Even Bob at one point dyed her hair a platinum blonde. So after she retired, though, she started running the elderly apartments here in town, and she loved to get out and converse with the elderly ladies and men. Bob never met a stranger. She always had 10,000 questions to ask you, and I know she interrogated everybody she saw. One thing about her is she always had a grin on her face. And it was always accented by her brown lipstick. That tube of lipstick she kept in her living room, and she wanted us to make sure she had it to put on. She said it made her feel better, and she said it also might help her catch a man. So she got tickled by the things she said, and she told me one time, she's like, I just can't stand to hang around a sourpuss. I like somebody that has a smile on their face. And she had her share of smiles, and she would get tickled at herself. She was always just a mess. As she grew older, she did become a homebody who loved her family, and her house was truly Grand Central Station for us. And every Christmas holiday, every holiday, in fact, has been spent at her house. And it's kind of been a joke the last about a decade because she didn't want us to take down her Christmas tree. She has a Dorothy and me. We shove it over in a corner every year, and she keeps it up year-round. And so we laugh about it at Easter and Thanksgiving. But even when I was growing up, she always would have a big spread on Sundays after church. And we would all go up there, and I can still hear her in the kitchen. She would always sing, "You are so beautiful to me," in kind of this twangish voice. But she would sing that. And I think that was maybe the only verse of the song that she really knew. But as she got older, she didn't really sit at the table. She sat in her recliner, her chair, and she would make her a big glass of sweet tea. It had more ice in it than tea. And she would turn on the TV to watch Wheel of Fortune. She couldn't miss that show, or Dancing with the Stars. But she would take that tea, and she would shake that glass of ice before she took every sip. It was very annoying. But I can just see her there, always in her black breeches, always wearing a flannel shirt. And she would sit there eating her chicken wings. For the last year, that's the only thing the woman has wanted for lunch and half the time for supper. So I can just see her there chit-chatting. But lastly, she loved her Sunday school class. She loved being in Miss Jimmy Thompson's class, and she looked forward to going and hearing about the Lord while she was able to do that. And she also loved going to the Gaither singings. Her favorite music probably was Gaither style or gospel singing, and she liked the old, old, old country music like Conway Twitty and Dolly Parton. And I can even remember when I was young, remember her in the kitchen kind of twisting or cutting a little rug to the music. But we were blessed to have her, and she was blessed to celebrate her 90th birthday this past February. She was able to stay home during this whole time. She was able to take care of herself fairly well, and we were thankful that the Lord took her and she did not have to suffer. And Bobby Jean, she will greatly be missed.
Thank you.
Bible says over in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 2, to set your mind on things above and not on things on the earth. And that's probably one of the more neglected scriptures and admonitions that we find in the Word of God, where it tells us that heaven ought to be that which is continuously for the child of God on our mind. I heard of a little boy who had gone off for the first summer for summer camp, and about midweek he had about had all of that he wanted. And he called home and was bemoaning to his mama, and his mama said, "Well, honey," she said, "are you homesick?" He said, "No, mama," he said, "I'm here sick." You know, in the year 2020, I think we can identify with that. We're kind of here sick, and our thoughts ought to be turned to a better place that makes us homesick, that of heaven. And so oftentimes we only think of heaven when we're at a funeral, or maybe we hear a certain song. But the Bible tells us some wonderful, wonderful truths, and that's where we need to get our theology of heaven, is from the Bible. But it gives us some wonderful reminders of what Miss Bobby has already experienced just in the short while that she's been transitioned into that place called heaven. I want to remind you just for a few moments about these. First of all, she is in a place created by the hand of God. See, Jesus said over in John 14, he said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions." He said, "If it were not so, I would have told you." But he said, "I go to prepare a place for you." What a place. What a place that must be. When you and I read over in the book of the Revelation about heaven, and we see the streets of gold, we see the gates of pearl. We see the walls of jasper. We see all those beautiful, beautiful stones as it's trying to describe that of heaven. And yet, it probably doesn't do it justice of what it actually is. R.G. Lee used to say that heaven is the most beautiful place the hand of God can create, and the most beautiful place that the mind of God can conceive. So, Miss Bobby, since this past Friday afternoon, she's in a place created by the hand of God. Second, she's with the Lord. You see, it's what makes heaven heaven is the Lord. What makes heaven heaven is the Lord Jesus Christ. And 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 8 says, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Now, when did that occur? Well, for Miss Bobby, that occurred 135, 140, so right around that time, Friday afternoon, when she drew her last breath here on this earth, and immediately she was ushered into the presence of Jesus. You know, imagine with me what she has already seen. She's seen the sights of heaven. She's already heard the sounds of heaven. She probably knows all the verses to that song, Cindy, that she used to sing. She's already been reunited with loved ones. All since in our time is just a short time. But she's with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I want to remind you, she's also in a much better place than we are today. We sometimes get the make the mistake that we think here we are, we're in the land of the living, and one day on our way to the land of the dying. But the opposite is true. Folks, we're in the land of the dying. I mean, slowly but surely. The older you get, the more aches and pains, and you feel that first thing in the morning. But we're slowly dying. My friend, we're on our way to the land of the living. Paul put it like this. Paul said, "I'm in a," this is King James language. He said, "I'm in a strait betwixt two." Now, if he had lived in North Mississippi, he'd have said, "I'm between a rock and a hard place. But I've been straight betwixt two. I have a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is much better." Now, I believe that when Paul had gotten that glimpse of heaven, when he'd got that vision of that, when he was caught up into the third heaven, and we find that over in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. So he was perfectly capable of being able to compare the two. And he said, by far, to be with the Lord is much better. Friend, you know, if we were to paint a picture of a perfect day, I mean, you know, hour by hour, listing everything that would go into making a perfect day, friend, that won't come near what a day in his presence really is, which she's already enjoying. And every day is the best day. Every day is the greatest day. She's in a much better place. She's also full of joy. You know, when you see that, that's how I remember her, is always that ever-present smile. Now, I never got a spanking, Danny, by her, but I'm sure you did. But, of course, the girls didn't, but I'm sure Danny did. But just that ever-present smile. But, you know, she is in a place of perpetual joy. Now, she knew heartache. She knew heartache here on earth, as we all do. But the Bible says in Psalm 16 and verse 11, in thy presence is fullness of joy. Is fullness of joy in thy presence, is fullness of joy. And at thy right hand are pleasures forevermore. Oh, a place of perpetual joy. Never a bad day. You don't ever have to tell anybody to have a good day, because every day's a great day. But I'll tell you something else. She's in a place of no mores. Bible said over in the book of the Revelation, chapter 21 and verse 4, that he'll wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain. For the former things are passed away. No more tears of sadness. No more funerals. I tell a funeral director friend, I said, you know, when we're in heaven, we're going to be out of a job. Song guys can still sing, but be no need of doctors. I said that at one funeral. Doctor came up to me and said, did you say that no doctors are going to be in heaven? I said, no, sir, I didn't say that. I said, there won't be any need of doctors in heaven. No need of a psychiatrist, no counselors, because you'll have the wonderful counselor, a place of no mores. She's in a place of rest. That's what Revelation 14 and verse 13 says. He says, blessed are those who die in the Lord. They shall rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. She's gone to a place of eternal rest. And we have a rest in Christ here on earth, where the Bible says, Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. He said, and I'll give you rest. But, you know, when you're 90 years old, you get tired. Maybe even get tarred. You know, I mean, it just, a lot of things that wear it. And sometimes we get physically tired. Sometimes it's emotionally tired. Sometimes it's spiritually weary. But the Bible says she's gone to a place of eternal rest. But you know, everything makes sense now. She's not concerned about who's going to win the election. She's not concerned about this, that, or the other. And everything that there's things in this earth that we have a hard time understanding, experiences that we don't understand. Maybe passages of scripture that troubled us, or that we try to make headway. They all make sense now. For the scripture says, for now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. What a place. What a place. It's a place all because of Jesus. A God who loved us and loves us. A God who was willing to send his son to die for us. And really the purpose of this life, and we look at 90 years old, and boy, we think, man, that's a long life. Well, I had a grandmother that lived to be, she was 98 when she died. My mother is 92. We look at that as long lives. But friend, the purpose of this life is to make preparation for the next life. The purpose of this life is to settle where you will spend the next life. I share this so often, so if you've heard this before, just please listen to it again. But I share this at funeral services so often. It's a story of when James Dobson, and we owe so much to James Dobson in family dynamics. But James Dobson, when he had his program, Focus on the Family, he had Pete Maravich. Now, when I was a little bit younger, Pete Maravich was, he was something. I mean, he was the greatest basketball player I'd ever seen. Called him Pistol Pete. He went to LSU, played professional basketball. But he got saved later in life. He was giving his testimony on James Dobson's radio program. And that afternoon, they were playing pickup basketball, and Pistol Pete Maravich dropped dead of a heart attack. Well, Pistol Pete Maravich had been the hero to James Dobson's son. And so he was trying to give his son some words of comfort. And this is what he said. He said, "Son," he said, "we must all face death sooner or later in this life, one way or another. Sooner or later, you're going to get the kind of phone call that Miss Maravich received today. I don't know if I'll have an opportunity to give you my last words, so let me express them to you right now. I want you to freeze frame this moment," he said, "in your mind, and hold on to it for the rest of your life. My message is to be there. Be there to meet your mother and me in heaven. We'll be looking for you on that resurrection morning. Don't let anything deter you from keeping that appointment. His is the only thing of real significance in your life. I care what you accomplish in the years to come, and I hope you make good use of the great potential the Lord has given you. But above every other purpose and goal, the only thing that really matters is that you determine now to be there." If some way, if Miss Bobby could come back and express her love to family and friends one more time, in lieu of what she has already seen, in lieu of what she's already heard and what she's already experienced, she would say to family, she would say to friends, "Be sure that you're going to be there. Be sure that you have placed your faith where God placed your sins upon his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you've made preparation in this life to be with him in the next life." You know, in a few moments, when we bring this to a close, and because of all of the rain, the inclement weather that we've had, we won't be going out to the cemetery. And there's a sense of finality when we come to a committal, when we come to the funeral service. But for we who know Christ as our Savior, and because of her faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, friend, it's not goodbye. It's so long. I'll see you again. And so, as James Dobson tried to get those words across to his son, I believe if Miss Bobby could possibly speak to us again, she'd want every one of us, family and friends, to make certain that we're going to be there because of the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you that your word is true. Lord, we thank you, Miss Bobby's faith in Christ, Lord, lived out over these many years. And we thank you, Father, that she's gone to that place of eternal rest. We thank you, Lord, that she is more alive now than she's ever been before. Lord, I pray if there's anyone, family, friends, under the sound of my voice that is not settled in where they're going to spend eternity, Lord, before that head hits the pillow tonight, I pray that they would do business with you and they would cry out to you and trust you to be their Savior and their Lord, to make sure they're going to be there. Father, I pray for this family. Lord, I know they're going to be embarking on a year of first. First Thanksgiving, first Christmas, first birthday, Mother's Day. Lord, all those special times of where she was the place where the family gathered. I pray on those days, Lord, that you would just flood this precious family with good memories. Father, thank you for a life well lived. Thank you, Lord, that we can come today and celebrate that life lived for Christ. We tell you we love you. We bless you. Praise you and honor you, because we ask this in Jesus' precious holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Mm-hmm.